Savvy.
Hey.
I'm Jacob.
Open hearts means we have open hearts to God so He can fill us up with all His answers.
You'll take new people, new friends into your life and you'll welcome them.
Love is good to be loved.
You should be kind, like always.
What would a Christian be without love and kindness?
When people have an open mind, the world could be a much different place.
Open to new ideas.
Just listen and try to believe.
We need to love our neighbors and love our enemies.
I think open doors means you open the door to Jesus when He knocks on your heart.
Everybody's just invited and they're just like, come on, we'll love you.
To help people who are sick all around the world to feel better.
No matter what they're like, they are a part of the church family.
Everybody's just invited, and it's like, come on, we love you. Kids really do have a much better handle on that than we do sometimes. Hello, 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 and welcome to this week's service from Felton-Viola United Methodist Church, where we really do try to live out the mandate of open minds, open hearts, open doors. We are a reconciling ministries church, and it's our hope that all who connect with us know that we try to see everyone as beloved children through God's eyes. Whether it's through our feeding and clothing ministries, our book and Bible studies, or our worship services, we want to find ways to connect with you and connect with God. In the past, we were able to do that in person, but today it's more complicated. Since we don't always know who's accessing our content, we're depending on you to reach out and to contact us so that we know that you are worshiping with us. We have opportunities throughout the week for you to virtually meet our members and to deepen your faith through study, reflection, and fellowship. At the end of this service is a slide that you may pause as you capture our contact information. We look forward to hearing from you. This week, we are continuing to follow the story of Saul, who we know as the Apostle Paul. We're going to see what kind of lessons we can learn from him and from his life. I'm not going to lie. There are times when Paul, well, he frustrates me. He doesn't always translate well into the 21st century, and believe me, I'm not going to shy away from the places that irritate me. Hopefully, we will come to see Paul and his message in new ways during the next few weeks. Now let's begin our worship with a familiar tune, but some alternative and very appropriate lyrics led by the Felton-Viola Chancel Choir.
In our homes we need to worship. Overflow. We adore Your words.
Today we'll be using hymn number 429 from the United Methodist Hymnal. Let us pray. For our country. O God, keep our whole country under your protection. Wipe out sin from this land. Lift it up from the depths of sorrow, O Lord, our shining light. Save us from deep grief and misfortune. Lord of all nations, bless us with your wisdom, so that the poor may not be oppressed and the rich may not be oppressors. Make this a nation having no ruler except God, a nation having no authority but that of love. Amen.
Hello, my name is Sarah Shepherd, and this is my godson, Finn. Can you say hi, church?
Daddy, hi.
Hi.
Yeah.
Yeah, good job. We'll be reading from Acts 26, 12 through 15 in the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. I, Paul, was traveling to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests, when at midday, along the road, I saw a light from heaven brighter than the sun, shining around me and my companions. When we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew language, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It hurts you to kick against the goads.
Okay, so don't get too hung up on the word goads. I know you're probably thinking, what in the heck is a goad? But we'll get to that, I promise. So Saul is on the way to Damascus with orders from the chief priests, no doubt to cause more trouble for the Christ followers. When he and those traveling with him are surrounded by what he describes as a light from heaven, was it a lightning strike or something more miraculous? We don't really know. What we do know is that Saul and the others fall to the ground, and they hear a voice asking, why are you persecuting him? I told you last week it was going to be a dramatic event. Whatever it was bright, and it was terrifying, and it blinded Paul, at least temporarily. I love it when he hears the voice saying, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It hurts you when you kick against the goads. Now, a goad is a traditional farming implement. It's used to spur and guide livestock. Jesus was saying that he had been prodding or goading Paul in the right direction for some time, that Paul had not paid attention, and that his failure to pay attention was hurting Paul and the others. I can relate to that. When God nudges us in a particular direction, I sometimes resist to the point that it hurts. I wonder if you've ever felt like that. Have you ever experienced God gently but persistently pushing you in a certain direction that you don't necessarily want to go? We don't really know what kinds of prodding God was doing with Paul, but apparently it was something. And I can imagine, from Paul's perspective, it might have been a little confusing. I mean, he already thought he knew what God wanted him to do, right? Whatever it was, he ignored it. He pushed it aside. Until God struck him down with a bolt of light that finally got his attention. It's not pleasant when you get hit in the head with a God-sized 2x4, like Paul did. I really don't recommend it. But here we have it. Paul is literally blind and helpless. In the meantime, God is poking and prodding another man named Ananias, who was a follower of Christ and likely one of the people that Paul had come to arrest. In Acts 9, God speaks to Ananias and he tells him to go and find Paul. I mean, what would you say if God told you to go and find a terrorist and help him? If God said to you, get up and go find Genghis Khan or Idi Amin, Saddam Hussein or Chairman Mao, I'm pretty sure I know what I'd say. Oh, heck to the no. Ananias says to God that he's heard about Paul and what Paul has done to people like him. God tells Ananias to find Paul and to pray for him. I can just imagine Ananias sighing, shrugging his shoulders at this odd and terrifying request. But in the end, he does it. He obeys God. He finds Paul, and he prays that Paul's sight would be restored. At that moment, the miracle happens, and Paul's sight returns, possibly to the surprise of both Paul and Ananias. Of course, we know that the experience had a profound effect on Paul. He goes from being one of the most zealous persecutors of the followers of Jesus to being his biggest promoter, interpreter, and supporter. Just imagine one of the terrorists I named a moment ago having a transformational experience like Paul did. And suddenly, instead of spreading hate and derision, they turned to love and grace and mercy. That would be something, right? That would get your attention in a big way, just as Paul's transformation got the attention of the people in the first century. If we move Paul's conversion to our time, we can draw an important lesson from it. Paul's change of heart was the result of both his experiences of Christ and of Ananias sharing with him. That's how it often works. Most of us don't have a Damascus Road blinding light conversion, but we do experience Christ in some way. We feel him speaking to us. We sense his love and feel moved to say yes. But we also have our Ananiases who come alongside us, talk to us, and offer us Christ. Through Paul's experience, he learned that conversion happens to us when we stop pursuing our own blind ambition, when we recognize God's prodding in our lives, and when we finally surrender to God's will. That's where the real adventure begins. What a radical shift from persecutor of Jesus' followers to his most powerful advocate. It was precisely this radical conversion that made Paul such a compelling witness. I found that it's impossible to reason and argue most people to faith. In the end, the most compelling case we can make for faith is our own experience of God's presence and how faith in Christ has made even the difficult days better and made us different people. Of course, it was not all sunshine and roses. For Paul and his companions, his conversion was a miracle. He went from being the hunter to being the hunted. Next week, we'll talk about the beginning of his development as a Christ follower and his theological interpretation of what it means to be what we call Christian. In the meantime, be intentional about staying in touch with your siblings in Christ. Pick up the phone, write a note, or send an email to a friend or a family member. Tell them your story, how Christ has impacted you. And if you have some encouragement to give, give it freely. If you need an uplift, reach out. I promise there are people waiting to hear from you. We are so glad that you were here today, and we hope that you have heard the words of Jesus as we've opened the scriptures. once again. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
I was
And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you until we meet again. Amen.